Now turn to part two. You will hear an interview with a woman called Gina Purvis, who is a pilot for a commercial airline. For questions 9 to 18, complete the sentences with a word or short phrase. You now have 45 seconds to look at part two.
Hello everyone, my name's Gina Purvis and I work as a pilot for a commercial airline. I'm going to tell you about my career. When I was about 10, I dreamt of being a flight attendant. Then the dream moved on to being a vet and working with animals, which actually I'd have hated because I hate seeing animals in pain. In fact, after school I went to train as a teacher. And after I qualified, I worked for a few years, but not with any great enthusiasm, I must say. So, how did I get started with flying? Well, my mum bought me some flying lessons for a birthday present, and I loved it from the start. I've been a commercial pilot for 10 years now, and captain for the last 5. The airline I work for demands that pilots have a minimum of 300 flying hours experience initially, and to be eligible to become a captain, it's 3,000 hours. At the moment, I'm flying people to their holiday destinations around the Mediterranean. Some people ask me if my work interferes with my private life, and friends outside work can struggle to understand why I'm not available on Friday or Saturday nights. It really helps that I'm married to a travel writer who understands the air industry. Other pilots, whose partners are bank managers and things like that, find it hard. And we don't have any children, so it all works somehow. Now, before I take off, I have to consult the notices to pilots, as they're called. That gives me news of airports having any problems. For example, one of the runways at London Gatwick is having work done at the moment. I also have to do some calculations to work out the weight of the plane, plus crates of cargo and the number of passengers. Then I put that with the route into a computer, plus the alternatives in case we get diverted, and the computer comes up with how much fuel we'll need. But often, at the last minute, we get notification of some more passengers, so that requires a further calculation and more fuel. I'm often asked if I have a degree in maths, as I need to do so many calculations, but I haven't. Like me, most of my colleagues have studied science at university. You do need to have a good head for figures, though. I often think it would have been good to study people management, too. The interior of the cockpit where I and my co-pilot sit is quite small and cramped. There's a practical reason for that. We need to be able to reach the controls just in case one of us falls ill. But there's space to put our jackets in the cupboard at the back. Everything we need is more or less reachable without having to stand up. I can't really move around during the flight. We used to have to get up to open the door if one of the cabin crew wanted to come in, but now we can do that electronically. And we can see on a monitor who's at the door to the cockpit or the cabin behind. Before I take off, I just need to check if there are any small defects on the plane. I receive a report of anything I need to be aware of, in which case I call for assistance. It can be just a little thing like a broken ice chiller in the front cabin. And if there are no real problems, then we're ready for the people to come on board. I've visited some wonderful places. What I like best, though, is flying at night. If the skies are clear, you can have stars above you and the lights of cities below you. And then there's the moonlight on the mountains. It's magical. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
Now you'll hear part two again.
Hello, everyone. My name's Gina Purvis, and I work as a pilot for a commercial airline. I'm going to tell you about my career. When I was about 10, I dreamt of being a flight attendant. Then the dream moved on to being a vet and working with animals, which actually I'd have hated because I hate seeing animals in pain. In fact, after school, I went to train as a teacher, and after I qualified, I worked for a few years, but not with any great enthusiasm, I must say. So, how did I get started with flying? Well, my mum bought me some flying lessons for a birthday present, and I loved it from the start. I've been a commercial pilot for 10 years now, and captain for the last 5. The airline I work for demands that pilots have a minimum of 300 flying hours experience initially, and to be eligible to become a captain, it's 3,000 hours. At the moment, I'm flying people to their holiday destinations around the Mediterranean. Some people ask me if my work interferes with my private life, and friends outside work can struggle to understand why I'm not available on Friday or Saturday nights. It really helps that I'm married to a travel writer who understands the air industry. Other pilots, whose partners are bank managers and things like that, find it hard. And we don't have any children, so it all works somehow. Now, before I take off, I have to consult the notices to pilots, as they're called. That gives me news of airports having any problems. For example, one of the runways at London Gatwick is having work done at the moment. I also have to do some calculations to work out the weight of the plane, plus crates of cargo and the number of passengers. Then I put that with the route into a computer, plus the alternatives in case we get diverted, and the computer comes up with how much fuel we'll need. But often, at the last minute, we get notification of some more passengers, so that requires a further calculation and more fuel. I'm often asked if I have a degree in maths, as I need to do so many calculations, but I haven't. Like me, most of my colleagues have studied science at university. You do need to have a good head for figures, though. I often think it would have been good to study people management, too. The interior of the cockpit where I and my co-pilot sit is quite small and cramped. There's a practical reason for that. We need to be able to reach the controls just in case one of us falls ill. But there's space to put our jackets in the cupboard at the back. Everything we need is more or less reachable without having to stand up. I can't really move around during the flight. We used to have to get up to open the door if one of the cabin crew wanted to come in, but now we can do that electronically. And we can see on a monitor who's at the door to the cockpit or the cabin behind. Before I take off, I just need to check if there are any small defects on the plane. I receive a report of anything I need to be aware of, in which case I call for assistance. It can be just a little thing like a broken ice chiller in the front cabin. And if there are no real problems, then we're ready for the people to come on board. I've visited some wonderful places. What I like best, though, is flying at night. If the skies are clear, you can have stars above you and the lights of cities below you. And then there's the moonlight on the mountains. It's magical. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
That is the end of part two.